Good morning, Dr. Praveen Kumar. So we can wait for a few more minutes so that the other participants can also join.
Okay, madam.
Please. Dr. Praveen, shall we start? Like, I think the others also have joined. So we can start the session. So I welcome Dr. S. Praveen Kumar, from PhD College of Technology. So to continue session on slope deflection method. So on behalf of all the participants, I welcome Dr. Praveen Kumar for the session. So now I'm handing over the session to Dr. S. Praveen Kumar.
Thank you, madam. Hope everybody is able to see my screen and hear my voice. Yes or no?
Yes, sir.
Yes, you are able to hear my voice?
Yes, sir.
So, in the yesterday's class, we have discussed about just I'll make 2 or 3 minutes of the summary and then I'll move to the slope deflection method. Yesterday, we have discussed about the introduction to the structure analysis. And it was been with already everybody would have been known with the content, but the instant just if this is a recollection, what are the structural loads, how the equilibrium equation, determinancy, and the analysis of your determinant structure. So with that, we'll proceed to the today's session. So even though yesterday we seen certain parts of the slides of the today's presentation, just I want to refresh this one. So this SDM, that is slope deflection method, was proposed by Professor George in 1915. It is an ideally suited to the analysis of continuous beam and the rigid jointed frame. So here in the basic unknowns like slope deflection, slopes and the deflection of the joints are found out. the moments at the end of the member is first written down in the terms of unknown slopes and the deflections of the end joints. So considering the equilibrium equation condition, a set of equations are formed and the solution of this simultaneous equation gives you the unknown slopes and the deflection. Then the end moments of the individual members are determined. This is a general kind of a procedure which involves a solution of your equation which developed, and a problem with more than three unknown is considered as a difficult problem for the hand calculation. So since this method is a very older method, and it was taken back by a moment distribution method with the help of computers to solve the solution for a number of simultaneous equations in a very short time. And further, it was in development with the, having a large number of structures with the help of system, that is your matrix method of analysis, which can be used or which can be represented by many of your tools what we use for analysis and the design in the structural engineering. So that is on based on your matrix method of analysis. What are the assumptions? So here we consider the main important assumptions are all the joints are rigid. So distortions due to the axial deformations are neglected. Shear deformations are neglected. These are the main three things that has to be considered. Apart from this, the rotations of joints are treated to be as an unknown. So yesterday we have seen this one. So even after there is a load that applies on a particular point, the joint, rigid joint, after deformation also it looks in the same position, and the distortions due to the axial deformations are neglected. So you can see BB dash is equal to CC dash equal to D del. So where even after there is a distortion, the axial deformations are neglected. So as I told you in the yesterday's class, so we have a unique sign convention. So mostly all your reference books are saying the same way of understanding about the sign convention which we use. So for example, if you take moments, the clockwise moments is positive, anti-clockwise is negative. Similarly, rotation clockwise is positive, anti-clockwise is negative. So you can see the representation in the figure also. So theta 1 and theta 4 will be in the positive direction, and theta 2 and theta 3 will be in the negative direction. Settlement, so right side support is below left side support, that is positive one, and the left side support below the right side support is negative one. So for example, in the beam shown here, your AB, the del is positive, and for BC your del is negative. So as I told you, these are the very important key points or key words which we frequently use in slope deflection method, that is FEM, that initial fixed end moments, shrinking of supports, side waves, and the slope deflection equation, equilibrium equation, and the shear condition, which the shear condition will be used in the part of your frames, analysis of your frames. So without further delay, we'll move to the derivation of your slope deflection equation. So in general, this equation, maybe your books and all directly maybe it may be given the equation alone, two or three equation, or there may be a possibility of skipping two or three steps in the in between the equation. As I seen from the reference books, all those are say, or maybe I try to give some better idea about this slope deflection equation. When a continuous beam or a frame is subjected to the external load, internal moments generally develop at the end of its individual moment. It's all clear. Everybody knows that if you take a beam, when the load is applied externally, there may be a possibility of internal moments. So this slope deflection equation, what it gives you is the relationship between the moments at the end of the member to the rotation and the displacement of its end and the external loads applied to the member. So as a put together of a combination of all the things that happens in the structure, this gives you an idea about the link where you can just take the values of the rotation and the moments and substitute the equation, get the values of the developed deflection or the bending moment here. So for example, let us consider a member AB of a continuous beam. So you can see a continuous beam. So we will be considering this A and B into account. When the beam is subjected to the external load and the support settlements, the member AB deforms. So initially, if you take there may be a possibility of deformations and the internal moment that induced at the end. So you can see this is the deformed position of your elastic curve, and this is the undeformed cushion. So this point may be taken as an, when there is an application of your load into the continuous beam. If you take these two parts into account, for example, A and B, so we may be in the position to know what is MAB and what is MBA. So if after applying the load with the length of L, so now what this MBA and MAB represent is the double subscript notation is used for better understanding. We can represent to the students also for the member N moments with the first subscript, that is identifying the member N at which the moment acts, and the second subscript is the indicating the other end of the member. For example, if it is A and B, what is A, what is B? If it is B and A, what is A? For example, if you take MBAB denotes the moment at the end A of the member AB. Similarly, for MBA, the denotes the moment at the end B of member AB. So this representation is very important. So after that, if you take applying a load and there is a possibility of undeformed position, you can draw a tangent at the point A and a tangent at the point B with an angle theta A and theta B, which represents the rotation of your N A and B with respect to the undeformed position of your member. So that is what is given here in the form of a tangent A and tangent B with the angle theta A and theta B in your elastic medium. So in a horizontal way. So similarly, there is a possibility of your change in the distance. So this relative translation between the two ends of the member in the direction perpendicular to the undeformed member, so we call this as del. So one by one I am introducing new terminologies or notations, you can understand. So we have seen MAB, MBA, theta A and theta B, now del. So del is nothing but the relative translation between two ends of the member in the direction perpendicular to the undeformed axis of the member. So this is supposed to be your del position. So the now next thing is psi. So it for example, if you take after your undeformed position is taken into account with the respect to the tangent A and tangent B with the theta A and theta B, there is a translating rotation between, that is del. So there is a psi which represents the rotation of the member card. So this psi will be nothing but del by L. So this del with respect to the L is nothing but your psi. So this part we will be discussing in analysis of continuous beam with regard to some deformation or some shrinkage that takes places in matrix method or flexibility method, that is stiffness or flexibility method. So where the psi represents the rotation of the member card, that is the straight line connecting the deformed portion of the member due to the relative translation del. So it is nothing but del by L is your psi. Similarly, the what we assume is as a psi, since the deformation are assumed to be small, so the card rotation will be of psi equal to del by L. So that is represented here. So in this particular chapter, what we taken into account as a sign conversion is, so positive will be your clockwise and negative will be your anti-clockwise. All moments and the rotations are shown in the positive direction, and in all the slides which I have presented, the slope deflection equation can be related by combining the end moments to the end rotation and the card rotation by applying the second moment area theorem. So that in the yesterday slides I have discussed about the conjugate beam method, first moment area theorem and second moment area. So here we apply second moment area theorem to derive the slope deflection equation. We will see one by one. So from this figure, so now we know what is MAB, what is MBA, theta A, theta B, del, psi equal to del by L, what is the card distance, what is the card rotation, tangent at A and tangent at B. So from the figure, we can write that theta A equal to del of, so for example, if you take theta A equal to del of BA plus this del divided by your length, total length is L. So similarly, if you go for theta B, so del AB plus del by L. we all know that this del by L is nothing but your psi. So we can rewrite this equation theta A as theta A minus psi equal to del BA by L, theta B equal to theta B minus I equal to del B AB by L. So here this del BA is a tangential deformation of NB. So we will be taking only this del into account for further proceeding with the derivation. That is, del BA is a tangential deviations of NB from the tangent to the elastic curve at the NA. So you can see here this position, from this position to tangent at the A to the tangent B dash, that is represented here in the form of that the end of B from the tangent to the elastic curve at the NA. Similarly, AB is the tangential deformation or the deviations of NA from the tangent to the elastic curve at the NB. So as of we are aware that we know what is second moment area theorem, that is the expression from this both the tangential deviations, that is del AB and BA, can be obtained by summing the moments about the ends A and B respectively. So this is very important. So this should be taken care that what the second moment area theorem tells you, that is del BA and del AB can be obtained by summing the moments about the ends A and B respectively of the area under M by EA diagram between the two ends. So now our job is to proceed further with M by A diagram. So the bending moment, as we all aware, that the bending moment diagrams for the member is constructed in parts by applying MAB and MBA, and if there is any external force that acts on the member, so that also separately has to be taken into account. So that is what the external loading separately on the member with the simply supported beam. So for example, if you take, so we have MBA bending moment diagram. So for MBA, what is your bending moment? For AB, what is your bending moment? And for a particular ML diagram, a simple beam bending moment due to the external forces. So 1, 2, and 3 is a simple representation of your bending moments. So assuming that the member is a prismatic one, so EA is constant throughout the length of the member. So we sum the moments of the area under M by EA about B and A ends respectively to determine the tangential deviation. So what we do is, now we take this into account. So I am introducing a new terminology here as GB and GA. I will tell you what is this GB. GB and GA is nothing but the moment that is generated due to your external loads. So del BA equal to 1 by EA. So as per your second moment area theorem, 1 by EA into MBA L by 2 into 2L by 3. So that can be taken in the representation from the figure here in the 20th slide, and write down the equation for your del BA. So after getting this, summing up all these things, so you will be getting del BA equal to MAB L square divided by 3A minus MBA L square by 6A minus GB by A. So keep this in the mind as a 4A equation. So similarly, we have to write for your del AB. So MBA L square by 6A plus MBA L square by 3A plus GA by A. So these two equations are supposed to be that taken for the consideration. So where in which GA and GB are the moments about the ends B and A respectively under the simple bending equation due to the external force. As I told you, this new introduction is nothing but based on this condition we are writing for MAB and MBA. So this three terms in the equations that is in the previous 4A and 4B represents the tangential deviations to the MAB, MBA and the external force acting separately on the member. So we have a with a negative term indicating that the corresponding deviation in the opposite direction. So simple. So normally we use minus symbol for the downwards or the upwards direction, which is in the opposite direction. So you can draw the tangential deviation due to MAB. So based on this equation, so for MAB, so if you draw this with respect to the MAB, so this in the left side m a b l square by 6 a. So from the equation I am telling m, m a b by c square, m a b l square by 3 a. So this two has been written. And similarly for b a, your tangential deviations, and similarly for your external loading, that is ga. So all this has been represented, this two equations are represented in the form of f figure. So keeping this, by substituting this deviations in the formula, so what we do is based on this del ba and del ab, so going back to the previous equation, this theta a minus psi of del ba by l, theta b minus psi of del b by l. So here you all aware that psi is nothing but del by l. Substituting this del ba and del ab here in this equation, we'll be getting this two equations. See, theta a minus psi equal to m a b l, m a b l by 3 a minus m b a l by 6 a minus g b by e a by l. So likewise, substitute the value and get for your theta. So to get this expression, to express the member n moments in the terms of n rotation, the chord rotation, that is psi and the external loading, we solve the equation 5 simultaneously for your m a b and b a. So if you rewrite the equation, this phi a equation is rewritten in the form that you are getting your theta outside. So similarly, it has been for AB and BA, it is written in the form of taking the values outside and substituting in the equation, we'll be getting this two equations. So here, these two equations are nothing but it indicates the moment that develops at the end of the member depends upon the rotation and the translation of your members, as well as the external load that acts in the particular beam element. So now suppose the member under the consideration, instead of being a part of larger structure, if it is an isolated beam with both ends are fixed. So this is for a general case. If it is an isolated beam for a fixed condition, so we'll be getting the equation in the form like this. The moment that could develop the ends of such a fixed beam, end fixed end moments, and their expression can be written like this. So theta a, theta b, and psi will be zero. Therefore, we'll be getting FEA, that is fixed end moment at a equal AB equal to 2 by L square, 2 GB minus, only we consider the external force. So maybe now you may be aware that what is MAB, MBA, theta a, theta b, del psi, and GA and GB. So based on the condition, as we aware that fixed end moments will be taken into account where we, theta a, theta b, and psi is zero. So we'll be getting the 7A and 7B equation. By comparing this 6 and 7 equation with based on the condition of your second term on the right side, we equate this equation, we will be getting this MAB equal to 2EA by L into 2 theta A plus theta B minus 3 psi plus FEA. So in most of the books, you may be finding this equation in a different way, in a different form, that I'll tell you, I'll show you in the future coming slides. And similarly, MBA equal to 2A by L into theta A plus 2 theta B minus 3 psi plus fixed end moment at the BA. So these are the two equations which expresses the moments at the end of the member in the terminal in the way that where it represents your end rotation, translation, and then the external loading, which is supposed to be your, as I told you in the first slide of the derivation. So we are going to combine all this together in the form of an equation. So that is supposed to be your slope deflection equation. So this equation is valid only for the rhizomatic members, which satisfies your linear elastic material and the Hooke's law. So here we eliminate your axial and the shear forces of the deformation that occurs due to the axial and the shear forces. So this equation, in general, it can be modified based on the requirement. So that I will tell you in the final slide how this is taken. The two slope equations have the same form, and either ends of the can be obtained from other. simplifying by substituting your a and b. So in a general way, if you want to write this equation, you can write like this: m f n f equal to 2 ei by l 2 theta n plus theta f minus 3 psi plus fixed end moment of n f. So here, in which n represents the near end of the member, where n f that is m n f acts on the subscript that f identifies the far end of the member. So if it is a, far end will be b. If it is b, the far end will be a. So like that, you can modify the equation based on the condition. So we have seen for the fixed end continuously. Now it's one end hinged. If there is a condition that you have a member with one end hinged, the slope deflection equation derived previously are based on the condition that the member is rigidly connected to the joints at both the ends, so that the member end rotations are theta a and theta b are equal to the rotation of your adjacent joints. When one of this members ends is connected to the adjacent joint by a hinge connection, if there is a possibility of having an hinge connection, the moment at the hinge end must be zero. So therefore, what will happen, it can be easily modified to reflect this condition with reference to the previous figure a b. If the b end of the member ab is hinged, then the moment at the b must be zero. So therefore, by substituting mba equal to zero in your previous equation, which is developed for your condition of fixed end moment and the continuous condition, so where you will be taken this into zero, that is mab equal to as such 2ea by l into 2 theta a plus theta b minus 3 psi plus fixed end moment at the ab. So mba equal to zero, so zero equal to 2ea by l theta a plus 2 theta b minus 3 psi plus fixed end moment at ba. So solving this equation, so you will be getting the value of theta b. So that is theta b equal to minus theta a by 2 plus 3 by 2 psi minus 3 l by 4 a into your fixed end moment at the ba. So similarly, to determine that theta b from the slope deflection equation, so this 11th equation has to be substituted in the 10a, that is this equation. So theta b is known, substitute this theta b here and find theta a value. So thus this called as your modified slope deflection equation for the member AB with the and a hinge at the MB. So MAB equal to is known. So MBA equal to zero. So substituting it, you will be getting your theta A, that is a member AB with the hinge at A. The rotation of the hinge end is given by theta A equal to minus of theta B by 2 plus 3 by 2 psi minus L by 4 EA into F, that is fixed end moment at the AB. And the modified slope deflection equation, so in general, so as you represent here, the same thing is represented in the form of another way: MBA equal to 3A by L theta B minus 3 psi, your fixed end moment at BA minus your fixed end moment at AB by 2 and AB equal to 0. So because the modified slope deflection equation at the 12 and 14 are similar in the form, they can be conveniently summarized in the form like, so as we highlighted in the yellow color in the previous way, nh. So here it is represented in the form of an rh. So mrh equal to 3a by l theta r minus I plus fem rh minus fem hr divided by 2. So just it is a representation where you can have your A, B, one end is A and another end is B, for another end is B and one end is A. So MHR equal to 0. So just for our understanding, this equation can be modified in the form of a general way to as a summary. So that is what here it is given. So in general, for rotation of an hinged end, so this equation is written like this: for rotation, so this is for your moment, this is for your rotation, theta h is equal to theta r by 2 plus 3 by 2 psi minus l by 4 a fem hr. So that's all about the different conditions of slope deflection. So based on this, in general, what we assume in our cases are what are the textbooks we use is that moment FAB plus 2EA by L 2 theta a plus theta b minus 3 del by l. So del by l is, we call it here in the derivation as psi. And apart from ba for the ba, f ba plus 2 a by l theta a plus 2 theta b minus 3 del by l. This is a general slope deflection equation we normally follow in our cases of the problem. So as I told you in the last, see, hope this derivation is clear. See, I'll just go through the derivation from the first slide, because it's supposed to be, I don't know in your books whether it is available or not. Few books have it one, and the other books are not having directly they have given the equation. So just a notation should be understood. After that, the derivations and all, you have to apply your second moment area theorem and then proceed further. So we have taken a beam. So here you assume what is your undeformed motion in your elastic curve. So we use two terminologies here. One is MAB and another one is MBA. And then what is MAB, and MAB is represented. Then going back to the level of understanding at the position, if there is a rotation that takes place, the rotation with respect to A and with respect to B is known. So that is theta A and theta B is the representation of rotation of NA and NB with respect to the undeformed position. Similarly, there should be a change in the position. That position will be represented in terms of del for two ends, that is the perpendicular direction. And we use a terminology called psi, which is nothing but del by L. Yes. Applying the moment, so as I told you, we just taken all the things into account, applying the second moment area theorem and getting this theta A and theta B into account. So once it is known, then substitute psi equal to del by L and go for drawing the simple bending direction. So for the simple bending direction, you have to derive your values for del AB and del BA. So once if you are aware that what is the value for del BA and del AB, substitute this del BA and del AB here in this equations, and you will be getting these two equations. So after this, you will be able to solve MAB and MBA. So this is for a condition when there is no possibility of having a simple continuous beam. If it is a fixed position of one end, so then you have to take theta A, theta B and psi equal to zero, and only you have to consider the G value, which is nothing but the external loading condition. So these two equations are taken into account. So these two equations can be modified based on the requirement. So this is a general thing. If you want, you can make a note, or the presentation will be given to you. You can get it, the presentation. So for one end in this is the condition. Yes. So with this, we'll move to the applications. So as I told you, continuous beam, rigid jointed structures, frames with and without swell, and we'll be solving problems on continuous beam frames, and some problems with some shrinking supports. In your reference book, I think there is no problem related to shrinking supports. So some handwritten notes I have with me, and that will be presented. Okay, just a quick refresh of the steps which we discussed in the last class. The first step here is computation of your FEM, that is fixed end moments. So the formulae for the fixed end moments for the action, in the next slide I'll show the table. The sign convention followed here is clockwise is positive and anti-clockwise is negative. So this is a complete table where you can have all your point load, moment, two points, cantilever, that is UDL, half UDL or varying load, everything you can find, MA, MB and RA, RB. So better, it is very easy to understand by solving the condition rather than remembering all these formulas. The next step is relate the member end moments to the joint displacements. The end moments are as follows. So as I told you, this is the equation which is developed, is supposed to be called as your slope deflection equation. MAB equal to 2 EA by L, 2 theta A plus theta B plus 3 psi plus FEM of AB. MBA equal to 2 A by L, theta A plus 2 theta B plus 3 psi plus FEM of BA. So compute the n moments for each member using this expression. So we can able to solve this one, and this equation is supposed to be your slope regression. Once you computed the n moments, then you have to formulate your equilibrium equation. These are obtained by making the algebraic sum of the moments at each joint as a zero condition. In case of frames, so with this frame, we have to use another terminology called as a shear condition. So that we will discuss later when we solve problems on frames. So once the first fixed end moment is calculated, end moment is calculated, then equilibrium condition is satisfied. Now solve the equation, get the values of theta A, theta B and del. So now after taking all the values into account, go back to the previous step in the B slope deflection equation. Substitute the values of unknown known displacements as obtained in the D, that is the step number D, theta A and theta B. This will give you the final end moments for the each member. From this, the support reactions can be calculated. So draw the shear force and the bending one diagram. Okay. So that's all about the introduction part of STM. So now I'll post you a quiz. So where you can able to recollect all the content which is presented so far. Maybe in your chat box you can see, wait for a while, I'll just post it. So maybe you can go to the link which is given in your chat box, and you can solve the 10 questions will be there. It will be very easy questions. So once maybe 10 or 15 minutes can be given for this to just to do the process. Please do it. Somebody can reply whether you are able to access the link. Someone from
yes, sir. Accessing the link, sir.
Yes, yes. So we have 47 number. So maybe leaving myself and two coordinators. That should be, I think, at least 40 should respond. So far I received one response. Simple questions. So whatever we did, 55. It's a simple thing. Those who are submitted, you can put it in your chat box that you have submitted it. So far I have received one response, that too I think the person who submitted, maybe unknowingly they have submitted without answering questions. Only one question has been answered, so maybe you can try for the next quiz. Because I have given an option that only one time it can be able to assess. There is a limit of our response option. So the mail ID which you have given in the Google form, you try to open it for you the answers. Once I get the number of submission, I'll be posting the answers and the scores of your thing. Only one have completed, it seems. What about others? Please put it in the chat box once if you have completed. I received four responses. So I am not expecting all 45, but at least 50% should respond. Okay, I will wait for another 5 or 6 minutes of time. Good, 12 have responded. So far 23 response, so I think it will be good to share you the answers soon. Hope you will receive the communication of your answers also. Somebody have got 9 out of 10 and only one have got 9 out of 10 and the remaining 7, 6, 5 are there. Want some time to complete or we'll proceed further? We'll stop the things, right? Maybe I think others are doing it. We'll wait for 2 minutes of time. Okay, I am just stopping the acceptance of the response right now. Thank you for your time to spend on this one. Maybe I should appreciate. I wait a minute. I'll just. Okay, somebody is asking for a wait. I am just giving the acceptance again. So please do it quickly. So person who got 9, I have posted in the chat box. Good. Should I wait or shall we proceed? Somebody have asked for time. Thirty responses I received out of 40. 10 more have to submit. But is it required to wait? Complete. Yes. Okay. Okay. The person who asked for the wait has completed. We'll stop this at the right time now. Okay, we'll move to the next of my presentation, that is analysis of your continuous beam. There are two more things and one more tutorial. In between, we'll have one more quiz after completing the analysis of continuous beam and the frames. Now, I'll be presenting myself with another slide which tells you about analysis of the continuous beam. And one more request to the participants. You just maybe hardly of 10-15 I'll be presenting on general cases and then we'll go for the break. When you come for the next session, try to have your calculator and the notes with you for solving a complete analysis problem on your own. So be with your class notes as well as with your calculator. Okay. Hope you are able to see my screen, right? Sir, no? Yes.
Yes, sir.
Yes. Okay. So far in the last class and the previous class, we discussed about the introduction and the derivation of your slope deflection equation, application of slope deflection equation, and what are the keywords to be used in the slope deflection equation. Everything we have discussed. And we will move to the two cases is available. One is your continuous beam and the frames, and now we will move to the continuous beam. So analysis of your continuous beam. As slope deflection method is a displacement method, the unknowns are displacements. So here we keep the unknowns as a displacement, and the axial deformations are neglected in this method, and the lateral displacement, if any, are the known values in the case of a continuous beam. So therefore, the unknown degree of freedoms are only the rotation of your joints. So I hope this you understood. So we know we are known with the lateral displacements, since we eliminate the axial deformation, and the displacements are supposed to unknown. So recall the steps for the analysis. So as we discussed in the previous slide, so we have few steps to be recalled here. Here the slope deflection equations are formed for each span separately. Then at the each end, moment equilibrium conditions are applied to form linear simultaneous equation having an unknown rotation. By solving this equation, the unknown rotations are formed. So these are the things which we are going to follow. So just for your understanding, for FEM, that is fixed end moments. So if it is 2N fixer, WL square by 8, WL square by 8, one point load with a different length, that is WAB square by L square, WBA square by L square, UDL, WL square by 12, WL square by 12, varying load, WL square by 30, WL square by 20, one end and another end, and then 5 by 96 WL power 2, 5 by 96 WL power 2 is equal. So that's all about general part of the continuous beam. So I'll take one problem right now, and we'll go for a break. And after the break, you just be with your calculator and your notes. So we'll solve one continuous beam problem, and then I'll move to the frames. There we have wave without wave, and that we will discuss, right? And then one more possibility is also there, that is with some inclination, that is inclined member of your portal frame in the syllabus. So that we will see. Okay, so this example one is analyze the two span continuous beam shown in the figure by slope deflection method. See, I have taken problems only from the reference book, so maybe the slides may be useful for you to present yourself, since the reference books are very clear. So you can see, analyze the two span continuous beam shown in the figure by slope deflection method, and draw the bending moment shape force and elastic curve where your Young's modulus is same for throughout your problem. So a beam which is having a fixed end AB and BC. So AB is applied with a 40 kN load at the distance of 2 meter, which the total distance is 4 meter, and BC is of UDL 20 kN per meter. So where AB is of I and BC is of 2A, BC of length 6 meters, total length of the continuous beam is 10 meters. So for this one, we have to do the problems. First step is fixed end moments. So we know that for a point load, as I told you, for the point load, W L square by 8, only L by 8, so that is minus of W by L by 8, W L square by 12. So since we have in the, as I told you in the previous slide, the direction that has to be taken, so opposite will be positive, that is minus 20, F BA is 20, FBC is minus 60, FCB is 60. Then the sixth step is slope deflection equation. So you all aware the equation. So since theta A is fixed end, so we have MBA equal to 2A by 4 into 2 theta A plus theta B minus 0 minus of 20. So if you substitute theta A is equal to 0, so you will be getting 2A by 4 theta B minus 0 minus 20. So if you resolve to 0.5 a theta b minus 20 is your MAB. Similarly for MBA, so 2 EI by 4 theta A plus 2 theta B minus 0 plus 20. So that is your fixed line movement with respect to BA. So if you think that theta A is 0, so automatically 2 by 4 EI plus into 2 theta B plus 20. So if you resolve it, EI theta B plus 20 is your answer. And MBC is 2 EI, that is E is here considered as 2i. 2i we have taken, so therefore 4 EI by 6 into 2 theta B plus theta C minus theta. So here your theta C is fixed, so it will be 0. So 4 EI by 6 into 2 theta minus of minus plus, so this minus minus 60. So 4 by 3 EI theta B minus 60. MCB equal to 2 EI into 2 EI by 6 theta B plus 2 theta C minus theta plus 60 equal to 2 by 3 EI theta B plus 60. So you'll be getting equation number 1.2, 1.3 and 1.4, 1.5 as a slope deflection condition with respect to the AB and BC. AB is a point load and BC is your UDL point. So the two steps, one is fixed end moment and the slope deflection is over. Now we are moving to the equilibrium equation. So considering the point B at the center, so BA plus BC equal to 0. So you know the values of BA plus BC. So substituting the values of your BA plus BC, EA theta B plus 20 plus 4 by 3 EA theta B minus 60 equal to 0. So you can rewrite it and get the value as 17.143. So based on that, substituting this in the equation of slope deflection condition, so you'll be getting, you are substitute this EI theta B in the slope deflection equation, you'll be getting MAB equal to minus of 11.428 kilonewton meter, MBA equal to 37.143 kilonewton meter, MBC equal to minus of 37.143 kilonewton meter, and MCB equal to 71. So these are the moments that is generated. So this will be used for drawing your bending moment diagram. So taking the shear force into account, we have to find the reactions. So treating each beam separately, as I told you, we are separating the beam AB and BC into account. So with respect to the moment that is calculated, so draw the figure. So for the particular free body diagram, you have to calculate the value of your reaction that takes places, RA, RB1 and RB2 and RC. So these are the reactions. So you know what is the moment that acts in the member, you know what are the external load that takes places. In AB it is 40 kilonewton point load, in BC it is 20 kilonewton meter UDL. So for this reaction, for this particular case, you can find out the reaction. RA equal to, so 11.42 at the point B plus 40 into 2, the half the distance, minus your 37.2 divided by your total length is 4. So you can able to find RA is 13.571 kilonewton. Similarly, RB1 is calculated 26.429, RB2 is calculated 54.28 kilonewton, 50 RC is calculated 20 into 6 minus 54.28, we are getting 565. So keeping the reactions and the moments, you can able to draw the shear force and the bending moment diagram. So we are our RA is 13.5, that is your positive direction. So it is written here. And then RB, R1, this is negative, this one is positive, and this one is negative. So with respect to, so you know what is your maximum deflection that takes places. So this is 40 and 60. These are the moments that generated with respect to your calculation, which is your, this is plus and minus, right? So this is the first problem. And the next problem is analyze the continuous beam shown in the figure by slope deflection and the draw. So in the previous case, we have point load at A and B. In this case, we have two point loads. One end is fixed and another one is free. Free load, that is A, B, C, D. AB is of 20 kilonewton UDL and BC is of 80 kilonewton point load and the CD is of point load at the end as a 40 kilonewton. So this is a problem we have to solve. So this problem we'll be discussing in the tutorial case, and I'll move to the next problem. So this is also a simple problem where, yes, this is another kind of problem where analyze the continuous beam loaded as shown in the figure by the slope deflection method. So where your support B settles or shrinks by 10 mm, take EA is E is 22 into 10 to the power 5 Newton per mm square, and I is 16 into 10 to the power 7 mm square. So sketch the bending one and the shear force diagram. So for the particular case, if you take you have a length of total length of 6 plus 6 plus 3, that is A to D. AB is of having ABC is of having your UDL 20 kilonewton meter, and there is a point load. So it, we have a total distance of 15 meters. So for this beam, you have a support sinks of B by 10 mm. So same steps are supposed to be followed. There is a slight change. So the first step is FEM, that is fixed end movement. So with respect to AB span, with respect to BC span, and with respect to CD span, we have to calculate. So in case if you take AB, FM AB equal to minus of WL square by 12. So 20 into 6 square by 12 is of minus 60 kilonewton, and the opposite side it will be of plus 60. Span BC is it contains a UDL. Similarly, half the portion, that is 3 meters or 3 square by 12, 3 square by 12, you will be getting minus 15 kilonewton meter plus 15 kilonewton meter. And similarly, CD, so it's a point load, the tax on the number WL by 8 plus WL by 8, so we'll be getting the value as minus 37.5 plus 37.5. It is clear. Now coming to the slope deflection equation, so AB is FAB plus 2 EA by L into 2 theta plus theta B plus 3 del by L. So 3 del by L is nothing but your sine. So we can, so theta A is fixed. So A is fixed, so theta A is 0. So since there is a shrinkage that takes place, that is S is equal to 10 mm negative in the right support that settles down. So what we do is MAB equal to minus of 60 plus 2A by 6 theta 0 plus that is theta A is 0, 0 plus theta B minus 3 into what is the del value is, that is 10 mm. So 10 divided by your length. So get your values for MAB. Similarly, substitute the value for MDA with respect to the shrink. So the shrinkage that takes place is with respect to AB and BC. So here also in BC, there may be a possibility of having the del value. So del is of 10. So you have to take, there is a scope for taking the much deflection in the point of AB and BC, not on CD. So there will be CD will be of 0, 3L by A, L will be 0. So that point you can eliminate in CD position, where you can able to find the value of MAB, MBA, MBC and MCB with respect to the shrinkage of support by 10 mm. Where in the span CD, there will not be any shrinkage, so you can directly calculate MCD and MDC. So once this is the particular part where we want to take for the support shrinkage, so based on that you have to go for joint equilibrium equation, that is joint B, joint BA plus joint NB equal to 0. So sum of these two equations, you will be getting the values for the joint B, you will be getting a value of equation number 7. This is the equation which is taken. See, at the most of point you have to go for the solving the case and come to a particular equation where it can be used to get the values of your rotation, that is theta or other points. So similarly, joint C is taken. So from the equation 7 and equation 8, we'll be able to solve these two equations and get the values. This is a ninth equation, and the seventh equation you'll be getting this final equation. So you substitute EA and your value here in the equation. So you'll be getting your theta c. So a value is given in the problem. Just to take this equation 10 and substitute the value of a. So equation 10 is ea plus 16 theta c plus 0.045 equal to 337.5. So substitute here. So ea is known, 3.2 into 10 to the power 5 kilonewton meter square into 16 theta plus 0.045 equal to 337.5 into 10 to the power 3. So you will be resolving the equation and get the value of theta c. So once if you know theta c, then you go and substitute here in 7th equation. Theta c is given. So theta c is known, ea is known. Now we will be able to calculate the theta b value. So theta b is calculated. So that's all about the calculation of based on your joint deformation. Then come to the final moment. So you know the equation MAB. So substitute your theta A and theta C, theta B and theta C here. You will be getting your MAB, MBA, MBC and MCB. So for example, if you take your MAB is 139.843 kilonewton meter, MBA is 46.354 kilonewton meter. So BC is known. So since there is a settlement, it should be satisfied. MBC CB is 83.35 kilonewton meter, MCB is minus 33.47, MDC is 14.5 kilonewton meter. So now you have to go for the reactions. So since you have A, B, C and D, so AB is to be taken into separation, BC is taken and CD is taken. So from AB, the span, so you have to calculate RA and RB1. So RA is 91.03 and RB1 is 28.97 kilonewton. So similarly, BC is RC1, that is the left side, RC1 is calculated with respect to MBCB, 73.22 kilonewton, and CD is taken about your C moment, that is RD is 13.4 kilonewton, RC2 is 36.5 kilonewton. So draw the shear force diagram based on the reaction that is calculated. So to find the final moment, WL square by 8 for the span AB and BC, WL by 4 is for the span CD. So you will be getting 90, 22.5. So these are the values, 90, 22.5 and 7. So these are the moments that is generated with respect to the condition which we calculated here, MAB, BC, CD, DC and DC, CB. So all these values are substituted and get the final value. So we will be solving this exercise problem. So one is on shrinkage and another one is on a simple case after this class gets over. So I think now I will take a break. So I will be back by 10:45. So where you can be prepared with your calculator and your notes. So we will be solving problems, one or two problems, and then I will move for the phrase. Right? Any clarifications if you have, you can ask in this two sessions, two presentation. Yes, madam, should I leave or I should stay? Can we have a break?
Yes, sir, we can have a break, sir. Satya, madam, are you there? Like, you want
yes,
to ma'am. Have some yeah, photo session?
Yes, ma'am. Kindly join for photo session. Please switch on your video. Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am, it's done.
So we can join for the next session at 10:45.